attend the elders' meeting. It is at 6 p.m. on this Tuesday. It is 6, right? 5:30. I was thinking, even as I said that, if that was wrong. 5:30 this Tuesday. We meet at the Summit Building, which is on Hanover Street over there close to Sam's Club. And we do that primarily because most of us live up there in Johnson City, and it doesn't make much sense to drive all the way down here to have a meeting. So we meet there, but you're welcome to join us for that if you would like to. Last piece of announcement, we're going to have some new flooring put into the hallway and this back room by the door beginning tomorrow. Yeah, that's good, isn't it? That tile that's there, I'm presuming, was put in when the building was put in. So we're going to cover that up with some wood flooring. It's going to look gorgeous, I am sure. So if you show up this week, you may have some construction to walk over. But they should be done before the week is over. So by next Sunday, the flooring should look really pretty. So don't be surprised when you see that when you come in. And with that, let's go to God in prayer, and we will begin our time of worship. God, we are so thankful that you love us. Thankful, Father, that we can gather as part of your family here at Central Christian Church. Thank you for those who can appear online and for the technology that allows that to happen. God, we just praise you today and give you all the glory and ask that all that we do will be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand together and praise him this morning. We're going to sing Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Shining in the midst of the darkness.
Songs. Amen.
It would be time for children's worship. Easter is coming. I don't know about you, but it seems like Easter frequently just springs itself upon me, and I'm usually not ready for it until it's a couple of weeks away, and then it dawns on me as Easter is going to be here before we know it. And when you're the preacher and you're in charge of doing things that have to be surrounding around Easter, not thinking about it until a couple of weeks before Easter gets here sometimes creates all kinds of problems. No. Yeah. There's some pictures up on the slide of some chicks and some little ducklings, and they're there because when I was a child, the strangest thing, part of growing up, I suppose, we would frequently get little chicks and little ducklings for Easter. It doesn't make much sense. My dad, as most of you know, was a career military officer, and we lived in military housing most of the time, and if we weren't in military housing, we were in a subdivision somewhere. We didn't live out on a farm where you would think chicks and ducklings would be, but every so often we would get chicks and ducklings for Easter. And to the life of me, as I was thinking about that this week, I don't have a clue whatever happened to those chicks and ducklings as they got older. I don't know if they went to grandma and grandpa's house somewhere or somebody who owned a farm or whatever happened to them, but ultimately they were gone because I don't ever remember having any grown-up chickens or ducks running around the house. But somehow they were there, and of course, being in the military as I was, or the child of a military person as I was, we moved every 3 or 4 years. And some of you, if you were familiar with military lifestyle, that's the way that works sometimes. And every 3 or 4 years you get up and move, which may not be so bad if you're the adult in the military, although I suppose that's not much fun either. But it's really tough on kids, because every 3 or 4 years you got to start all over again. And so we would get used to where we were. We'd be in a place, we'd be in a school, we'd just be getting to know people after 3 or 4 years, and Dad would get orders and we would move somewhere else. The only time we spent more than 3 or 4 years in a place was in Atlanta, Georgia, because my dad went off to Korea to fight in the war way back then after coming back from World War II. So we spent quite a bit of years, late 40s, early 50s, there in Atlanta. And that wasn't so bad because my grandparents on my mom's side lived in North Georgia, so we got to see them frequently, and that's why I think maybe that's where the chickens ended up. But I don't really know for sure what happened to them. One of the first things we always did, though, that I can remember as a child, when we moved to a new place, was to find a church. Mom and Dad were great church-going people. I credit my mom and my dad for giving me the Bible foundation I have today. My dad was always preaching. He was a military person, but he loved to preach. And so many, many times when I was growing up, he would be a preacher in some little church somewhere. And I can remember we would travel out into the middle of nowhere, it seemed like, and he would preach at some little church, and we'd all four of us, Roberson kids, would be drug along behind him and Mom, and we'd go somewhere. And almost invariably after church was over, somebody in the congregation would invite us all to lunch. And we'd show up in somebody's house. I'm not sure they always knew how many kids were coming, but we always had plenty to eat. But we were always eating at someone's home, strangers to us kids, of course, and really not that well known to Mom and Dad either, because it wasn't a permanent position. He just liked to preach. So if he got word or somebody knew of a place where a preacher was going to be gone for a week or two, he would volunteer and go out there and do that and drag us along behind him. But it was always tough as a child growing up never to have any roots. And when I ended up in Tucson going to law school many, many years ago and met Debbie, it was amazing. She was born and raised in the same town. I'd never heard of such a thing. Yeah, she had friends that she had gone to elementary school with, kindergarten with, people she had known her whole life, and she still does know some of those people. I don't have anybody like that. My brothers and sisters don't have anybody like that. And when I look back over my life and think, you know, what happened to all my childhood friends? I don't have a clue. The only one I know of at all was after we left Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and moved to the Panama Canal Zone in the late 50s, one of my friends died of polio. That's the only memory I have of a friend we left in Fort Bragg. A few months after we left, he died of polio. Back then, polio was still something you feared. Polio was still an illness that you lived with. We didn't hide from it like we sort of do today from COVID. But you knew it was there, and you took your polio vaccines, and you did what you could. Remember the little sugar cubes, and they dropped the little thing on them? I don't know about you, but I'd much rather do that than get a shot. Why they can't come up with a vaccine they can drop on a sugar cube and let me take it, I'd be the first in line to get whatever shot they wanted to give me, which may be why I'm diabetic. Yeah, too many sugar cubes. I don't know, But when we would do that and move, like I say, the first place we would end up would be at a church somewhere. And those church members, most of whom were just like us, they were military people. And the base, usually where we were at, would have a church right outside the base in the little community. And almost all the time, at least half the people there, if not more, were military personnel and their dependents. And so they appreciated the same kind of concerns that we had, that you better make friends quick, because if you don't, they'd be gone. And of course, when you're in the military, you moved every 2 or 3 years, but the people you knew, it seems like they were always moving. Every year you lost somebody because their parents got transferred out, and the next year somebody else transferred out, and the next year somebody else transferred out, somebody else transferred in, but there was this constant revolving door of kids and friends and people you knew who in a blink of an eye were gone. I look back over my life and sometimes I regret that. I don't necessarily regret having been the dependent of a military person. We had a good life. I got to see a lot of stuff that most people never get to see. They were born and raised in Irwin. They never get out of Irwin. And I can remember one time Debbie and I were involved with the youth in Yuma, Arizona, in our church there. And we decided we were going to haul a bunch of them, not just us, but other couples as well. We're going to take a bunch of them to the San Diego Mountains, which was about 2.5 hours or so away from Yuma. Yuma, if you know anything about it at all, is flat, dirt, hot. 2.5 hours away of the San Diego Mountains. Gorgeous, luscious, cool. And every once in a while, we'd go over there and we'd spend the weekend, or we would camp, or we would do whatever. But we were taking these kids that direction. We got about 1.5 hours down the road, and we took a you-know-what kind of stop at a little rest area there and a little gas station. We all went in. Everybody went in and did whatever they needed to do, got us a soda, got back in the van. I'm driving the van. We're not 5 minutes down the road, and one little girl in the back says, "Mr. Roberson, I need to go to the bathroom." My first thoughts were not very Christian-like. But then I said, "Why didn't you go while we were stopped back there?" I didn't have to go then. And in my coolness, I said, "Well, don't you know that every time we stop somewhere, you go to the bathroom?" I mean, that's just the rule of travel, isn't it? It doesn't matter if you have to go or you don't have to go. If you stop and there's a place to go, you go. And she said, "This is the first time I've ever traveled." I felt that tall. I was used to traveling. I knew if Dad stopped for gas or stopped for whatever reason, us kids went to the bathroom and did what we needed to do, because we were driving another 3 or 4 hours and we weren't stopping. You learned to hold it back in those days, right? It never dawned on me that I had a kid with me who had never gone out of Yuma before in her life. And I thought, wow. But it made me learn later in life, obviously, that not everybody has the same kind of upbringing. We don't all grow up alike. The only thing I can really hang on to growing up was we had church families wherever we went. And my dad and mom stayed in touch with many of those people through the years. And I can remember some who were preaching at some of the churches we were at, who became great preachers. One of them ended up being one of my school teachers when I finally went to Abilene Christian College. He had been a preacher at the church at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, in a little town of Fayetteville outside of Fort Bragg, and he was now a professor at Abilene Christian College. And so I enjoyed talking to him. I didn't remember him very well, but he remembered my dad, and he remembered us. And so I had sort of a connection there. But throughout the world, wherever we would go, every once in a while, we moved about 5 times when I was growing up. Sometimes we'd end up in a place where mom and dad knew somebody who they'd met somewhere else, and we were just crossing paths again. And it's weird the way that sort of works. And again, I don't know how all of you grew up. I don't know all of your backgrounds from the time you were just infants till the time you left home and went to wherever you went to go. But we all have those kinds of stories, don't we? And if you grew up in the same town and never moved, then you've got all kinds of stories all involving the same people. And if you were like me and you moved frequently, then you've got similar stories, but they all involve different people. And of course, as a child, you weren't too worried about keeping up with them. So like I said, I really don't have a clue what happened to any of the people I grew up with, simply because that wasn't high on my list as I was growing up. But I do know one thing. Wherever we went, as we settled into a church somewhere, that church became family real quick. It became family because, for again, many of the people there, that's all the family they had. Their family was scattered across the world somewhere, and we were right there at the right moment for just a few years together, and we were family. And I really got a sense of that's what the church is supposed to be. It's supposed to be family. And I appreciate Daniel leading that song for us. We are part of the family of God. And whether you've been here in the Jonesboro Church, Tri-Cities area for years and years and years, or if you grew up here like some of you did, most of us are transplanted here. But we're family, aren't we? Here at Central Christian Church, we're getting to know each other. We're trying to build relationships. We're building families. We don't have the moving quite as bad as it used to be. Many of us who are here are getting old, and we're sort of settling in, and we don't really want to move again if we don't have to. But it's still the idea that we need to be family with each other. We need to be able to take the time to build relationships and get to know each other more maybe than what we have. And as I think about Easter especially, those thoughts run through my mind about being family and being united and having a common fellowship that should draw us all together. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. We have a God who died on a cross to save us. And I suppose, "O Lord, my God," is probably one of the most favorite old hymns that we can sing, and it's not really that old. With that one verse that goes, "And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, caused him to die, I scarce can take it in." Can you imagine a God who would do that for us? A God who created the universe. A God who owns everything here. And then there's us. Little people. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but we're just people. Paul says, you know, somewhere along the way, consider how not many powerful, not many rich, not many of the megamaniacs ended up in church. Partly because they probably presumed they don't need God. Their life is set. They don't have to worry about it. But most of us who have come to know our God realize we can't make it without him. We need a relationship with God. We need to be able to hang on to something bigger than ourselves, because if it's just about me, I'm in big trouble. I really don't have a clue how people who have faith in nothing bigger than themselves even bother to get up in the morning. If this is all there is, why would you want to be here? If you didn't realize that somewhere, someday, somehow, there was going to be a greater place where you were going to be than this place, I can't imagine why you'd have any joy. When you look around the world and see how horrible it can be, and you come to think this is the best it's ever going to be, is this? What's the point? And people who have no God, that's the way they live. That's all they have to live for. That's why they can do some of the things they do, is because they don't hold themselves accountable to anybody. I think I shared before, somewhere back, a comment that I read somewhere along the way that said, "Why would you expect ungodly people to act any way other than ungodly?" Think about that for just a minute. We look around this world and we see evil things that evil people do, and it shocks us. And we're thinking, how could anybody do such a thing? What's wrong with you? But if you think about it, if they don't know God, if they have no sense of morality, if they don't have any concern for others around them, and it's all about them, how else would you expect them to act? It should not surprise us that ungodly people act ungodly. That's the way they're going to be, because they have no reason not to. Now, don't misunderstand me. There are some people who don't believe in God who are good people, in the sense that they make nice neighbors and they care for you and they'll do stuff for you. But it still staggers my imagination to believe that they think this is all there is in this world, is just this. Because when I think that my God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. I don't understand it. But especially as I approach Easter, it dawns on me just what a great God I have. And as I start thinking about Easter and Palm Sunday and what we're going to be doing, here over the next few weeks with Easter egg hunts and whatever else we're going to have. I am so thankful. I have a God who loves me. I have a God who cares for me. I have a God who gives a hoot whether I live or die. He really is concerned about me. And church, he's concerned about you. Rachel, he loves you as much as he loves me. Chi-Chi, he loves you as much as he loves Rachel, and he loves me. And we could go around this room all the way back to Mac and Becky and say, God loves you too just as much as he loves the rest of us. And we have a God who died on a cross because he loves us so much. That last song we sang, we could sing Easter morning. It's all about a God who loves us. And by the power of his resurrection, one day those of us who know him as our God will be raised just like he is. Paul says, in the twinkling of an eye, we'll all be changed. Whether we're died already and we come up out of that grave, or whether we're alive and changed because Christ has come back, one day our God is going to come back for us. And church, we need to be excited about that. I don't know why we can't get excited about that. We have a God who wants us so much that he's done everything he needs to do to get our attention. And yet we live in a world where so many people couldn't care less. I've got to believe that had to be the biggest heartache Jesus suffered here on earth, to know that most people couldn't care less, that he died on a cross, that he gave his life for them the same way he gave it for us. We had an elders meeting a couple of weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, I guess it's been now. We brought up Easter. Church, I don't know about you, but I've missed potlucks. Now, you can tell I haven't withered away to nothing yet, but I've missed potlucks. And I think I missed them again because as I was growing up as a kid, one of the neatest things we would do in these new churches as we got together and we got to know people, we would have a picnic on the grounds. They were outside most places. They'd haul the tables out of the classrooms, we'd set out under the trees, and us kids would be running helter-skelter all over the place, and ultimately somebody would say, it's time to eat. We beelined it back to where the food was. And that idea of family eating together and coming together, I guess, has such a memory in my mind that potluck meals and church family meals still mean a lot to me, because I have those memories of always having those family people, even who I didn't know very well, join us around a potluck table. They would all bring something to eat, and we would sample all kinds of stuff. Sometimes you would eat stuff you didn't even know what it was. But it was good. Absolutely, it was good. I've never been to a bad potluck, let me tell you. I'll be the first to admit, there is no such thing as a bad potluck. I don't care what you got to eat, it is good. Because church people cook better than anybody I know. And we would come together and have those potlucks. And as I thought through Easter, even having been here, and the tradition we had, and again, it's just tradition. There are no rules about Easter. We don't have to do certain things on Easter. But our church calendar fits some things together. And historically, we here at Central Christian have had a potluck breakfast at Easter. Those of you who know me well enough know I am not a morning person. If the day started at noon, that would be just fine with me, let me tell you. Now, I'll be up at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, so don't be looking down your noses at me, because some of you are in bed at 9 o'clock. I've got 6 more hours to go sometime before I'm in bed. And again, we all live on different time cycles too, and it's okay to be different, isn't it? If you love mornings, by all means, get up and have your coffee at 5:30 and listen to the birds chirp and do whatever you want to do, but don't call me till 9 o'clock, okay? But we get up for a sunrise service, and let me assure you, church, one of the neatest things about Central Christian Church, our sunrise is about an hour and a half after everybody else's. Seriously, it is. because of the hills and this apartment complex that live right here to the east of us. How many know which direction the sun comes up from? East, right? And when you've got buildings and mountains to the east of you, the sun doesn't come up so early. Praise God. When we were in Yuma, flat, okay? No mountains, flat. Our sunrise service was like 5:15 in the morning. We got there, right, Deb? We got there. And it was almost always someone had one of the members had a large orange grove in his house set out in the middle of it. And he had a huge deck built up above his garage area, I think it was above his garage, but it was a large deck. And that's where we would assemble. And we would be out there, and there might be 30 or 40 of us out on this deck of this house. And let me tell you, at 5:30 in the morning in Arizona, especially in Yuma, it is quiet. It is still. The stars are gorgeous. Let me tell you, there is nothing like an Arizona sky. And when that sun creeped up over the little hills that we did have, and the first rays of sunlight shot across that sky, it was breathtaking because it was as clear as could be. And we would be up there at 5:15, 5:30 in the morning, and usually for about an hour, we would sing, we would have a little service, and we loved it. And then at 6 or 6:15 or whenever we'd get down off of there, we'd head out somewhere and usually go find something to eat, or we'd have a church breakfast at the building, and then we'd hang around till 10:30 or so for worship. It was a long day, but it was a beautiful day because we were with family. We were with church people who we knew loved us and we loved them. But I don't mind getting out here at 8:15. And that's about the time our sunrise service is, because we don't have to be any earlier than that because the sun isn't coming up until then as it comes in from the east. So we're planning this Easter an 8:15 sunrise service. That time might fluctuate a little. I'm going to have to get up one morning just to see what time the sun's coming up here, unless somebody out there would like to do that for me. But somehow we'll make sure what time that sun's going to come up over there. And we will set the time. It'll be close to that. It won't be the crack of dawn kind of stuff. But we'll have that. And as we were talking with the elders a few weeks ago at the elders meeting, and we've announced this already, they said, sure, let's have a potluck breakfast. And so we're going to have a sunrise service over here like we do normally on the back side of that little apartment complex across Fox Street here. After that, we'll come over here, and at 9 o'clock, we'll have a potluck breakfast. Bring whatever you want. There is no menu. There is no schedule. Just bring whatever you want to eat, and we'll meet back here in the fellowship hall. We're still going to practice as best we can social distancing and COVID awareness. So what we're intending to do is set the tables up with the food on them, and I think we elders have agreed we will serve the food. So we won't have everybody touching the utensils and everybody grabbing stuff. We will be behind the table. We will serve you. And if there's too much food and the five of us elders can't handle it, we may ask some of the wives to help us. Wives, that's just a precursor to what you may have coming. But that's the plan, so we can practice some safety, so those of us who are still a little apprehensive about the COVID stuff can still feel comfortable enough, if you want to come join us for a potluck breakfast at 9 o'clock on Easter morning. We'll probably go a table at a time to even come up through the line so we don't have all of us, you know, going through a big line at the same time. We'll make that work somehow so we can be cautious. And then the plan is still then to have an Easter egg hunt after the breakfast is over. So if you'll start bringing your individually wrapped candies over the next week or so, we'd appreciate that so we can start filling the eggs up. And then they'll do that somewhere around 10:15 or so. And then we'll have our normal worship service at 10:30, just like we always do, even though it's really only 9:30. But we'll do it at 10:30, okay, on the clock, all right? I I'm a homey kind of guy. I love traditions. And I love the fact that we were able to do that. And last year, you know, somebody said just a few days ago, the anniversary of COVID hit. And of course, most of us who like basketball know it hit right as the conference tournaments were ending, right before March Madness began. So this is the time. And it's been a year now since we've been living under those COVID requirements and restrictions, and most of us are sick and tired of it. Most of you have done quite well. It's been a change in our lives, hasn't it? Something I don't think any of us ever thought we would ever have to put up with. And we're still putting up with it. All of you are still wearing masks. If you ever want to be in the church building for half an hour without wearing a mask, volunteer to preach. You know, and then you can come up here, take your mask off, and preach for half an hour. I hope COVID starts going away. I hope by the summertime maybe things are back to some kind of pre-COVID normalcy. But I'm not holding my breath even for that. But I do know this. Whether we're wearing masks or we're not wearing masks, we can still be family. We can still have relationships. We can still fellowship with each other. We can still do things together without fear. And again, please be as cautious as you need to be. And again, I know we're all different. And what bothers some of you doesn't bother somebody else. And most of you know I used to have a pet black widow spider living under my bathroom sink long ago. It was the cutest little thing. Before we were married, as Debbie says, she still married me, and she's terrified of spiders. I won't talk about how she killed my black widow spider. That's a story for another day. But we're all different. Some of you don't mind having spiders crawl all over you. Some of you don't mind that. Some of you don't mind messing with snakes. Others of you, your skin's crawling already just thinking about it. But church, the idea is we are still family. We don't all think alike. We don't all act alike. We didn't all grow up alike. But we are still family. And doing family things is what makes us family. So I'm hoping, I'm praying that plenty of you will think, you know, Easter's long enough. We didn't do Easter last year. I don't know about you, but watching Easter on the TV is not doing Easter. Not being with a bunch of Christian people celebrating Easter is not doing Easter. And we did the best we could last year, and I'm not knocking that because that's what we needed to do. Churches were shut down. It's okay. But I'm glad we're not shut down. I'm glad we can get together. And I'm hoping that enough of you will think, we can be cautious, we can be careful, but we need the fellowship. We need to be able to spend time together as brothers and sisters, that some of you will show up for this on Easter morning. And we'll have a wonderful Christian experience of getting together and doing stuff together. You know, the Bible says that early church, and I'm going to jump way over, Shirley, in Acts chapter 2, talked about how the early church got together. It says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers in the early church. Day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with gladness. See, food is always in the story. They received their food with gladness and with generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And church, I really believe one of the reasons God's church grew so fast when it first started that we read about there in Acts chapter 2 was that those verses we just read. They did things together. They hung out together. They met together. They were always together. And as that verse ends, finding favor with all the people, because the people who were around them knew, we're not playing baseball on Sunday morning. We're going to meet with our Christian brothers and sisters. We're not going to go to the show on Wednesday night because we're meeting with our brothers and sisters. And it wasn't just Sundays and Wednesdays. It was daily, it says. Can you imagine how close you get to be with people if you're with them almost every day? And you're doing something together that you know means something to all of us? And I'm hoping and praying that every one of us here this morning, and if you're watching online, you too, have one big goal in your life, and that is we want to serve our God and give Him glory. And if all of us are focused on that, and that becomes the goal of all of us, the number one priority, we could watch church growth be what the early church saw. Jesus says the world knows you're my disciples by the love you have for each other. And nothing shows love more than a desire to be together, a desire to want to spend time in each other's company, doing things together, whatever it is. Eating's one of them, but there's all kinds of other stuff we can do too. Even if you just want to come together and have a game night, play cards for a few hours, whatever you want to do. But I think the fact that we don't do much of that like we used to is part of the reasons we're watching churches not grow the way they used to. We segregated out church from the rest of our lives. And as we do that, the world watches us and they're thinking, well, they can't love each other as much as they claim to. They don't even see each other except on Sunday. If we really love each other, we want to see each other more than just on Sunday. And we build those relationships so that we are seeing each other more than just on Sunday. I was talking to Debbie a couple, I guess maybe yesterday, thinking, and Shirley, bless her heart, when I sent her my sermon notes so she could put these slides together, she wrote back and said, you're not going to preach a sermon anyway. And she was half right, okay? She was half right. We're not preaching the whole sermon I thought I was going to preach this morning. But I was talking to Debbie about it, and I said, you know, here's what I'm thinking instead of what I prepared. And I had a hard time this week coming up with a sermon. I'd be the first to admit. I don't know why, but I was struggling with what to bring to you. And so I was talking to Debbie about some idea that I had that I was going to change my sermon and change it like this. And I wanted to get up here first thing off and say something, and Debbie said, you know, Bob, that doesn't really sound very good. Maybe you shouldn't say that. So I bowed to her superior wisdom, and I didn't do that. But I'm going to do sort of that now. One of the struggles with being the preacher is that usually in a church family, the preacher and his family is treated differently than everybody else because he's the preacher. And I'll be first to acknowledge Debbie's struggled with this because in Yuma, where we moved from, we were part of the church. We had buddies and friends that we hung out with. We had kids the same age as Veronica and Valerie, and all their kids hung out with our kids, and we were always doing stuff. And most of you know by now, we had a group that met in our home on Tuesday nights, and it met for some 20-something years every Tuesday night, unless it rained in Yuma, and then we're out dancing in the rain. Because Yuma gets 2 inches of rain a year. That's the average. But some of those people that we were with week after week after week after week are still close friends of ours. 4 or 5 years ago, whenever that was, we had one of them call us out of the blue and said, we've got a timeshare in Crossville, and we're going to rent a cabin, and we've invited 4 of our couples that we used to hang out with, and we'd like you and Deb to come join us for that. And we went over there and had an awesome 2 or 3 days spending some time with friends from Yuma that we hadn't seen in years. But all of you know, when you've got close, good friends, even if you hadn't seen them in years, as soon as you see them, it's like you've never been away from them. And we had that bond, and then you become the preacher, and it's, oh, he's the preacher. And the preacher's family sort of gets set aside because they're the preacher. And those of you who have ever been in that circumstance, and those of you who grew up in church, know this is true, that the preacher and his family is somehow looked at differently because he's the preacher. And I was going to start my sermon this morning by saying, I don't want to be your preacher anymore. And Debbie said, Bob, that doesn't sound good because they would think you don't want to be the preacher anymore. And so she said, maybe you should change it some to make it not sound quite so harsh. And she said, you know, maybe I don't want to be the preacher, just the preacher here anymore. I want us to be family. And I want all of us to be part of that family. I don't want you treating me and Deb and Veronica differently than you treat everybody else because I'm the preacher. Don't misunderstand me. I love preaching. I love the fact that Shirley, bless your heart, Shirley, instigated the mess that got me back up here. I love doing this. I love being with you guys. I love helping you. I love counseling with you. I love spending time with you. But there's something about being the preacher that still has a little bit of a wall between us because this is the preacher. I don't think they had that problem in the first century. Now, maybe Paul, who traveled around and around, was the visiting evangelist. That's different. But you can read the early church, and they didn't have this clergy-layman separation. They had family. And what I'd love to see us do for 2021 as we come out of this COVID restriction stuff is to start doing more family stuff, to start being together more, to start spending time together doing things as safe as you want to make it. And I'll respect that completely because I understand that. But I want us to be a church family and not just a church. I want us to have what seems like many congregations have lost. And that is a sense that we really are in this thing together. That we've got a unifying bond through our God and Savior who redeemed us. And we can come together as a church family and really be family. That's my prayer for this year. That's what I'm hoping for. And as we move forward toward Easter especially, my hope is that you'll spend some time in prayer over the next couple of weeks thinking, what can I do to help make Central a family? What would be my role to help us draw closer together as a family? What would it look like if we were the kind of family this first century church was? And then I'm going to ask, as God answers your prayers, because believe me, I know God answers prayers, okay? And if you're faithful and you'll pray to God and say, God, give us some wisdom, give us some insight, give us some ideas, God will give them to us, not just to the preacher, to you too. And you can share them with me, with the elders, with each other, and we can start talking about what can we do as we come out of this COVID restriction stuff. To be more of a church family. I'm ready to get back together. I'm ready to do things together. And I think we can. And I love you guys. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for being with us today. And thank you for helping us as we go about our lives day by day, week by week, year by year. And as we look back over this last year, God, caught up with all this COVID stuff. Some of us have struggled. Some of us had a real hard time being locked away, being stuck behind shields and masks and all kinds of stuff. And God, I don't know the future, but you do. And so our prayer to you is that you will guide and lead us in the way that is best. That you will help us as at least this church family as we come out of some of the restrictions we've been under. That God, you'll help us to redevelop, to reconnect, to delve into each other's lives in such a way that we truly become family again. That we're able to see each other more than just on Sunday morning for a couple hours. God, give us the wisdom to know how best to do this. Give us the wisdom to see how that can work. And God, my prayer is that everyone in this room, everyone watching online, will be praying, at least over these next couple of weeks, God, that you will reveal to them and to us your plan for this congregation. The way we can be the family you want us to be. Thank you for sending your son, for not sparing him. He died on a cross for us. He died on a cross for all humanity. Most don't care. But God, help us to be a church where we can show how much you love not only us, but others we come in contact with. And we can treat and act them in such a way that they will see you living in us. And that will raise their interest. And they'll want to know about you. And we can tell them about you. And they can look forward to the time, as we sang a little bit ago, the power that raised you will raise us too. God, help us to look forward to that with such a joy that we can't help but share it with others. Thank you for this family. We give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, tradition is that we sing an invitation song. A song that allows you, if you want to come forward and share stuff. All kinds of stuff. Not just prayer requests, although we do that. Praises, informations, something you just got on your heart that you just want to say, you know, I just want to share this with the church today. I think it'd be awesome if we started all the way back in the library and every one of us just said something to each other this morning. One of the things I'm looking forward to in this year is to give you more of a chance to participate in the service. It's not just all about me and Daniel and Rachel and Mandy and whoever else might be up on the stage, but it becomes our time to be together so that we really are family here too. If you'd like to share something this morning, I'd invite you to do that as we stand and sing. Both came up and said, please remember Amy. Most of you know Amy spent a day in the hospital with some pain and doing some tests, and they're still not sure what's going on with her. And the prayer is that some of those tests would reveal what's going on, so the doctors might be able to do something, but if they can't, then our prayer is that God can, and God would do something to help Amy. She's got a lot of pain, a lot of discomfort, and she would, I'm sure, covet our prayers. Paul came up and said, would you please pray for our neighbor Christy? And she lost her job, but she got another one, so that's a praise. But she also has a son who's been having some difficulty, and if we could remember him as well, we'll do that too. Shelly came up, and Shelly's got a second interview for a job interview she's looking for, and so we're excited about that. And of course, we'll be praying that God's will be done in her life, but that's always exciting. Donnie's come up, and Donnie says, you know, I just want to praise God for my house, my family, my friends, everything that's going on in my life. I just want to say thank you. You know, in church, that's all of us, isn't it? We are all so blessed. It is amazing how God just keeps taking care of us day after day, in spite of what we do, in spite of who we are, in spite of circumstances sometimes, we still have a God who loves us and provides for us, and I'm so thankful for that. I would ask you to be in prayer for me, if you would. I don't know what I've done. Most of you know I've got this bad ankle that flares up from time to time. A couple of years or maybe a year ago, a VA doctor finally looked at it and gave me a brace, which helped considerably, changed my life in reality. But the last couple of days, it's really been hurting. I don't know if I've done something to tweak it, but it's swollen back up and hurts like you know what. So if you would just pray that some of that pain would go away, I would appreciate that. Anybody online there, Alex? Okay, let's go to God in prayer. God, we are thankful that you care for us, that you look after us in so many ways, and every one of us, Father, like Donnie, could just give you praise for the good God you've been to us throughout our lives. And God, we know that it isn't just the material things that we are thankful for, but we are thankful that you have redeemed us, that you loved us so much that you sent Jesus to die on a cross so that every spiritual blessing we need could be ours. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for putting your Spirit in us. Thank you for hearing our prayers, for guiding us, for giving us insight, giving us wisdom. Father, in all the things we do, my prayer would be we would seek your understanding first. God, we do pray for Amy. We pray for a healing for Amy as she's been struggling with some severe pain and issues. God, that you would be with her and help her, I pray. God, as I see Claudia here, I thank you that she's feeling better today and that you've helped her get through this last week. God, we pray for Paul and Emily's neighbor. We're thankful that she found a new job so quickly after losing her other one. God, we also pray for her son who's struggling with some issues in his life. And we just pray, God, that you would touch that situation, that if there's some way Paul and Emily can be a blessing to Christy and that circumstance, we just ask that you use them whatever way you wish. God, thank you for Shelly's opportunity, and we just pray you help her as she goes for her second interview, and if that's the job you've got planned for her, that you just give her the words and help her say what needs to be said, and you just watch out for her as she looks to change her job. God, I know there's others in this room likewise who are looking for different positions. First of all, we're thankful for the jobs we have, thankful for the opportunity we do have to work. But God, I know some people would like to see a change in scenery, for lack of a better way to say it. And so I pray that you would be in their lives, and if that's your will for them, that you would lead them to just the right place you want them to be. More importantly, Father, the place they can be where they can shine for you. And that would be the goal for all of us, whether you're a preacher like me, whether you're retired like others, or whether you're working somewhere, that God, our goal would be to let you shine through us so that people will see you living in us and give you the glory. God, help us as we move toward Easter. Help us to be seeking your will. Help us to be wise as we come out of this COVID restrictions. They've all been lifted and there's still some issues to be dealt with. But God, I pray you help us. I pray that you be with our nation, that you be with our government leaders, the people who are making the decisions for us, telling us what to do and how to do it, that God, they would seek your wisdom. They would be asking you for help. and you would give them that wisdom as they make decisions for all of us. Thank you for this land in which most of us here live in, for the blessings we've had in our lives here. And God, I pray that because we are so blessed, that you would help us to be a blessing to others. Help us to love on people. Help us to be kind to the clerk that waits on us, to be patient with the other people in traffic lines. And God, to just be the person you want us to be to your glory. I do pray that you'd help me with my ankle, that you would ease this pain some for me as it's been flaring up this last week. I thank you for Daniel and for Rachel this morning, for Mandy. God, as they lead us week after week in our worship, choosing those songs with which we can praise you and learn of the glory that you are and the grace that you've shown us. Thank you for being with us. I give you all the glory today. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, be blessed. We do have an awesome God who loves us. I'm sorry, Alex. Okay. Let's add that. Remember, Madison came up last week asking that we pray for her dog. Her dog's pregnant. We'll pray for anything. You know, the Bible says God knows. He numbers the hairs on our head. And I think if he does that, if he knows enough about that, he's concerned about a sparrow that falls, that he's concerned about us and our pets. So let's add that. God, we do pray for Madison. We pray for her dog. We pray, God, that you would be with that little girl as she goes through her pregnancy, that you would keep her safe. Our pets mean so much to most of us. And God, they're part of family. And so I just pray that you be with them and take care of that situation as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Be on the lookout this week for somebody you can bless. Smile at somebody who looks like they need a smile. Okay, they can't see you smiling because you're wearing a mask. All right, so wave at them. Act kindly. Be the kind of people God calls us to be. I really believe most people enjoy being around joyful people. Let's make being around us something they look forward to. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for being with us here. We know, Father, as we leave this building, you will be with us wherever we go. And we thank you for that as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Be blessed, church. Getting old, you forget stuff. You're not dismissed yet.
Filling up in his sufferings. You realize that's lacking in regard to the sufferings of Christ. In other words, Jesus Christ is not done giving.
Nobody wanted to hear from me today. That's hot. Bob didn't want to do communion. There's no mic wire on this. Nobody wanted to hear from me today, so we made it work. If some of you saw, we replaced our front door yesterday at our house. The front door was there probably for since the beginning of the construction of the house. And we replaced it, and Heather said, what are you going to do with the door? And I said, well, I think we're just going to cut it up and throw it in the dumpster at Hampton Inn since I'm still employed there one day a week. And she said, well, why don't you put it for free on Facebook and see if somebody will, maybe could use it. I said, Heather, it's a pretty rough-looking door and it's old. She said, well, it'll be easier to do that than cut it up. So I was like, well, we can do that. So we put it on there, had like five or six people reply quickly that wanted this door. This guy came and got it, and George was there helping us, and he helped me load it on top of the vehicle for him. And we were talking. I said, what are you going to do with this door if you don't mind me asking? He says, well, I'm going to refinish it. I'm going to put it on the front of my house. I started thinking when I was hearing Bob's sermon today, you know, Jesus took us and with his blood has refinished us. We are perfect in his eyes because we're covered with his blood. And that's how God sees us. We are perfect in his eyesight because the blood that Jesus shed on the cross. But last week during our communion meditation, I had mentioned, why do we take communion?
As I said, is it just checking off a box week after week that we do? But my prayer for us is that we really take a few minutes and think back on what Christ has done for us on the cross. Can you imagine what was going through Jesus' mind at that meal? He's sitting with his 12 disciples having a meal and knowing one of them will betray him. He must have been thinking too that he was getting ready to go to the cross and suffer a terrible death for the sins of the world. Not just the semi-perfect people that sin, but for the world, he died. Sometimes I think we may think, how can a person love us so much to die for something that we did that they had no control over? And I'll tell you how. Well, it's actually quoted in the Gospel of John. And it's John 15:13 says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down his life for one's friend. Jesus laid down his life for us. He went to the cross in our place. He hung on a cross for our sins. He was beaten and whipped for our sins. But he went freely. He wasn't bribed to go to the cross. He did it because he loves us. He wants us to know him on a personal level. And that we've been talking about for the past weeks of the relationship of Christ and relationship with each other. But during that meal, he says, do this in remembrance of me. He wants us to remember what he did for us on that cross. He wants us to focus in on that, just not on Sunday mornings, but all throughout the whole week of our life. But when we partake in this bread and the cup, we need to focus in on nothing else but what he did for us on the cross. Nothing else matters in our lives, church, if we put Christ first. We need not to forget the sacrifice he willingly gave for us so we may live with him forever. Bob said it so many times, and I've kind of taken it and used it myself, but we're just passing through this world. It's not our eternity home. And thanks be to God for sending his son to die on a cross for us. If we accept his free gift as our Savior and we try our best to follow his teachings, we can live with him forever. And that's what the focus really needs to be, that what he did on the cross is, you can't compare it to anything else in the world. No other's love will ever compare to it. So as we take communion today, I ask you just to take a few minutes to really reflect on what Christ has done for you in your life, dying on the cross, blessing you, answering prayers for you. That's what really matters. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for your day. Thank you for your son. Thank you for loving us as much as you did to send him to be our Savior, Lord. And as Bob said earlier, probably the most heartache he had while on this earth was people, with him knowing people would never follow him and never accept him as their Savior. I'm thankful that you sent him, Lord. I'm thankful that he is my Savior. I can't show enough gratitude and praise you enough for that. Thank you for being here with us as we partake in your communion. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As we traditionally do, since COVID, we'll come down the middle aisle. The cups are double stacked. And go to the left, and we'll partake together. that last supper that he had with his disciples, I believe they were fellowshipping there prior to this meal. I believe they were talking to each other, and that was his 12 closest people that knew him. And I believe they were family. But during that last meal, he took a loaf of bread, broke it, and passed it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Eat this and remember of me." The scriptures say he also took a cup and poured and passed it to his disciples, saying, "This is the blood of the new covenant, shed out for you for remission of sins. Drink this in remembrance of me."
Neat thing about being family, so I can forget about communion. You guys can laugh with me, and it's okay. I don't know if it was my nostalgia of going back that made me think we used to do communion before the sermon, and maybe my mind was just gone. But while I was sitting here listening to John, and you all were coming up after he spoke, somehow I didn't have my eyes shut, and my voice showed up in my head and said, "Look at their feet." And I started watching the feet of those of you who walked in front of me here. Not a one of you have the same pair of shoes on. Some of you are wearing sandals. Some have socks. Some don't have socks. And as I watched that, it dawned on me, and maybe this is just God talking to me, saying, not a one of them are alike, but I love them all. Every one of them are following me with those feet, and they're walking where I walk. And just to challenge church that we are all different. We don't all like the same stuff. We don't all have the same history. But we can all walk with God and be family. That's the goal for us, I hope. Thank you again for being here today. So you get a double blessing this morning. I love you guys. Be blessed. You're dismissed.